Hi. Hello, everyone. Again, for those who were there, and hello for the new ones. I'm going to do a presentation where, in fact, I'm not going to do the presentation. I ask other people to do it for me because I'm getting more and more lazy every year. So this is the usual VLC, where we are, where we're going, and whatnot. So the agenda is we're going to speak about 3.0, a bit of core, Android, iOS, and media library. So I will start about VLC 3.0, but what you have to remember is one of the goal and what we're explaining to our users, which is a very simple motto and so far got quite well understood, is that VLC is playing everything and runs everywhere. And this is getting everywhere. If you look at a forum, when people, the first answer, like, oh, I can't play this file, everywhere it's, oh, you should try VLC. And then you got memes about people trying to play, I don't know, waffles on DVDs, and yeah, VLC will play that. So that's a good thing, and we need to go on that. So, yes, I got some very nice snow. Yes, I should change the encoder, but I'm not encoding anything. Do you have it?
It's the post processor.
Possibly. Yes, that's why I'm not using libVLC, I'm using LibOffice. Anyway, so on Windows, we're still supporting Windows XP. In fact, VLC still runs on Windows 2000 if you do a bit of hack. On Linux, we are running since 2.6.12. And on macOS, we are still running from 10.7 to 10.12. The slide is wrong, of course. And now we're running also on Chrome OS. If you look on mobile, on Android, we're supporting from Android 2.2, which is Android 8 for the API, until 6.0 or even 7.0. On iOS, we are supporting all the major ones, all the flat ones, 7 to 9.3. And on WinRT or UWP, we support 8, 8.1, and 10. So VLC is everywhere on the desktop, everywhere on the mobile, but we also need to be everywhere on the TVs. So we have a port of Android on Android TV, which is good. It's not great. There is a lot of work to do, but it actually works, and it's quite good. Even if you have a Sony Bravia, which is a 4K display with the cheapest MediaTek CPU, because they are cheap people, but you can do 4K 60fps decoding there, so that's quite well. So Apple TV also, and we're working on the Xbox One that should be out soon. And then we hope that someday some people tell Panasonic and LG to stop being stupid and allow native code so we can get VLC there. Anyone from the Mozilla Foundation, please send this message. We want to have native code on Firefox OS. of course, they won't listen. But yeah, so that's quite well. The problem is that everyone is confused because the version on VLC on iOS is 2.7 something or 2.0 something. The version on the desktop is 2.2.4. The one on Android is 2.0.6, and on UWP it's 2.0. No one understands anything about that. So that's very bad. So on the 3.0 is going to be the first release where we're going to try to have one release on all the platform with the same number. Okay, so I'm going to fail, but let's try still and at least have numbers that make sense. So that the major number will be the version of the libVLC. And so you have more or less the same support of codecs, depending also on which version of libAV and FFmpeg you're building against, but that's a joke. So there is a lot of focus on 3.0 about having hardware decoding, which is CPU, zero copy on the CPU, but also zero copy in the GPU with VRPI, DXVA, where instead of displaying and going through the filter video chain with a full image, you just pass the reference to the CV pixel buffer or the eDirect3D texture and so on. So we have DX3D 9 working in that way, DirectDirect3D 11, media codec, of course, for Android, VDPIU, MAL, video toolbox also, and soon VR API. And on that, there was quite a bit of work, and also to have like a HEVC decoding 4K, and that is so far mostly for Direct 3D 11 and media codec. And of course, we also have been working on asynchronous decoding, but Thomas will speak about that. We have a new subtitle rendering engine that is now using Halfbuzz and that can do fallbacks of fonts. It was done by a Syrian guy who is in the middle of the war and who has 2 hours of electricity per day, but when he has this electricity, he's mostly working on VLC. Yeah, some people are hardcore. If you thought some of you were, nope. So that's why next VDD is going to be in Alep, okay? So it does font fallback and based on free type, but also does a complex layout, text layout, using Halfbuzz, which is only so far GTK, Qt, and Firefox, and Chrome who have this integration. I don't think any other media player actually has it. Maybe Libas does it, but I'm not completely sure. A lot of work on VLC 3.0 about supporting new stuff or old stuff or crazy stuff like DALA org or 608 inside MP4 or all the usual crap we have like WMV inside MP4 or some AGDVD file support. And of course, because we are getting better, we spend a lot of time rewriting most of the outputs, mostly for Android and Windows, where we have a Direct3D 11 output, and we wrote everything on Android, and stuff like that. So that's mostly the big stuff for VLC in general. And now Thomas is going to speak about what he's been doing on the core of VLC.
So hello, I'm Thomas. This is my first presentation in English since a very long time, so please be kind. So I will talk about the addition I made in the core of VLC. So the core is a very delicate and dangerous thing. It can leave you in a very depressed state when you get your 10th refusal on the mailing list. Some people may know it. But you are very happy when you finally find a very good solution. So let's talk about the feature I added. Thank you. So I added support for asynchronous decoder. So there are some hardware decoder like OMX and Media Codec for Android that is based on OMX that are asynchronous. So that means that you can get the input and or the output buffer from another thread by registering a callback. And there was a problem with that because in VLC there was only one a call to decode one and more input frame, and that return one output buffer to be displayed by the video output. So the main problem was that you can get output buffer ready from a thread and you have to wait the core of VLC to call the function to finally get it. So this was very bad for performance. So I added a call, decoder Q video, decoder Q audio, to Q output buffer to the video output from any thread. So this fix, this improves the performance of on Android a lot, especially, yep. And this fixes some deadlock because on some Android device, there are a certain number of input buffer or output buffer that may, you have the output buffer that wait for the input and the input that wait on the output, and this leads to some deadlock. But it's now fixed. I added the support for libvlc dialog API. So, this allows a developer to register a callback that is called when VLC asks a dialog, ask to render a dialog to the user. So Android or Apple developer can implement it and use the native toolkit, graphic toolkit to display a dialog that is asked by VLC. The main purpose is to access content protected by a password, so HTTP, SMB, and other, because the user can finally type the password. This also solves the issue about the self-signed certificate, because you have to ask the user if he can trust the if he accepts the certificate, And we finally can save the, we let the user the trust of saving the credential. That leads to the next feature, VLC Key Store. So this is a basic key store. You have to, that allow to save a user and a password from a content based on a URL, a realm, something, a protocol, or something like that. So I first added a VLC credential helper in the core of VLC. So that is used by every access module that may need a password. So when they call this helper, it will first try to fetch a password from the key store. If you don't find a password, it will then ask the user via a dialogue. And we implemented a few key store modules. So Duncan did the K-Wallet module in C for KDE. I did the libsecret module for GNOME. Felix did the keychain module for Apple. And we finally have a file module where you can plug an encryption module that is used for Android starting Marshmallow because there is finally an API to encrypt content based on the hardware and the user session. And we need to do it the same for Windows. Network browsing. Oh, this is a new slide. I forgot I did that. Previously in VLC 2.0, we have only one you can browse with only one protocol, that is UPnP, and it's a crap because you have to discover the whole directory. So, and it's problematic in UPnP, that is a virtual that has a virtual library, so you can have a loop and you can loop inside. You can have an infinite loop because there are directories that link to the same directory. So I added a readdir function in the core that allowed to ask to have a list of files inside an URI, so inside a directory. So we now support FTP, secure FTP, SFTP, UPnP, NFS, and NCMB for browsing. So this is very this is used mainly for the mobile port of VLC. So now decoder fallback. I added the ability to restart a decoder module. So a decoder module is like AV codec, media codec, libmpeg2, mp3. So why will we need to restart a decoder module? First, when the input change. So we have the bucketizer that detects that the input format change, and that in that case, you may need to kill the current decoder module and reload a new one based on the new input. So the new module that is loaded can be different than the old one. And the second case is very dumb. There are some hardware decoder, media codec, that fail very too lately. So that means that after the init function, you will pass the init function. You will you can have a failure when you first get the input buffer, or later when you first get the output buffer. And you get a failure for perfectly valid video. So in that case, you need to kill this decoder to ban it for the current session, for the current input, and use the next decoder that will be AV codec, in general. And the third case is to restart the decoder when the output format is not handled. So this third case is very important because it finally allows to enable pass-through for a lot of for patent-free open source codec like Dolby, Extended SFR, TrueHD, and DTS-HD. So that, how it works? So I added a dummy pass-through codec that does nothing, but it requests the output if it can handle pass-through for a certain codec. So if it can't, you go to the next decoder that will be FA codec or maybe another one, or media codec. And if it works, you will have a pass-through for this decoder. That's still a work in progress. I need to work, I added in the mailing list support of extended SH4. I need to work on TrueHD and DTSHD, but this will be easy now that everything is in the core. So, Geoffrey, can you come to explain what you did in Android?
Hello, so I'm Geoffrey. You may know me as Decans on IRC. I present you the work for this year on the Android version of VLC and the incoming features. So for now, we're at version 2.0. We released it in early June after a few months of beta. And we plan, so as JB said, we plan to sync VLC version 3 with desktop and other mounts, another port. So as of today, we have on Android on the current version 32 million active users and 57 total downloads. If we add the old version of VLC we have on Android, which is now deprecated for 2 years, but still active on the store, it makes us 52 million active users and almost 120 million downloads. And so with this stable release, we have to kill the old one to have finally only one VLC version and not one old version called beta. So this version 2.0 brought the Chrome OS port, which was made by Arc. It was a special deal for Chrome, but Google abandoned this and now we'll have APK support. So Chrome will directly run the Android application. And we unified the app. We had a special target for TV, for Android TV. Now we have the same APK targets too. So you can try TV UI on your tablet or phone if it's Android 4.2. It's especially useful for HDMI key running Android, but not a certified TV, Android TV. We also brought network support thanks to Thomas' work. So we have all the supported lists, SMB, UPnP, all FTP variants, and NFS. We added the first feature, big feature we added at this branch is video playlist. It was really asked for for most users. So now we handle in the same way audio and video media. We can chain a video. We added a pop-up mode. Other video players do it. It's like Facebook bubbles. So it's you can have a video window over any other application. And we also handle multi-window mode. So the native mode in Android 7 and the LG and Samsung special port. We also brought back playback history, which had been disabled in the meantime. You cannot save playlist. There is a filter feature in the current playlist for people playing a bunch of music and want to quickly switch to a specific one. We improved design. We improved directional pad navigation for remote control and RTL support. We also finally added a subtitles node. It's quite automatic in the video. And unfortunately, we drop Android 2.1 Eclair, mainly because of native features. Yeah, it's quite sad, but as Eclair was rolled out in 2010, early 2010, we should have around 1% user on Eclair. So this is a screenshot of VLC running on Chrome OS. So that's a Chrome window. So you see the exact Android UI. And now I'll speak about the incoming features. So for VLC 3 or maybe some in VLC 2.1 branch if we have time for that. So first, big VLC 3 features like Chromecast off torrent according to the state of the core support for this and the capabilities of mobile devices. Currently, I am working on the media library integration. I let Hugo present you this in detail, but long story short, it's a unified library for all VLC version to handle media indexing the same way, and it's better. It has a better structure that we had in Android for now. So it will, in the future, allow us to scrap media. So have nice covers, proper titles, descriptions. We may eventually index network media. That's really useful on NAS devices. So as we support Android TV, that's a really cool feature to directly access any NAS media. And media library architecture allows us to have a more powerful search, like artists, genre, albums, that we cannot really do for now. We also started porting on Android Auto, so Google provides an API to show audio browsing and playback in your car. We are also preparing an extension API to develop some plugin for VLC. And unfortunately, again, we'll drop Android 2.0 for you. But this time, it's Google's fault. Because the really important AmpCompat library for Android apps will drop this support, so we'll be forced to. So this is a screenshot. I prepared two screenshots of Android Auto, though that's the browser you will see in the car. That's the playback interface. And this screenshot is showing the plugins integration. So I developed a podcast extension to save and browse your favorite podcast and a Google Drive extension. As you guess, you can easily browse your Drive media and play it on VLC. And for Drive has its own file picker, but podcast extension runs on the VLC file browser. So that's it for Android. And I'll let Hugo present you the media library.
So hi, I'm Hugo, and I'm going to talk to you about the media library. Probably quite a few of you saw some commit logs or some like small references to that if you're on some IOC channels. And now it's, I guess, the first time we're trying to talk about that publicly. So as you know, we have like VLC for Android, we have VLC for WinRT, we have VLC for, which one I forgot, Tizen, iOS. Sorry. And each of those ports is rewriting the way to handle media and to offer you with a list of your videos, a list of your albums, artists, and all. And as you guess, every time, it's just like a new wheel which gets reinvented. And what do you do when you have three or four versions of something which are competing? You just add a fifth version. So this is what this does. It's actually already a rewrite, or like a write from scratch of a media library in C++ 11, which is not surprising if you know me a bit. And instead of solving like all those problems multiple times in different ways, we're going to solve it hopefully one and just once and for all. Because quite a few of those issues, like for instance, you have an artist which has four or five albums, and all the albums have the same title. And you have to be able to guess that it's actually different albums and it's actually a real life case. I mean, we have samples for that. So this, I don't know how this works in the actual port, but maybe it works on Android and it doesn't work on iOS, or maybe it works on Tizen and it doesn't work on WinRT. And every time different developer has to write the same logic to do that again. Which is why we're going to do it once, and we're going to share the code. Because I mean, what if we start a new port for a new mobile version of something? We don't want to do that again, like, not yet again. So what we want to do is to have one implementation, and well, it has to be at least as fast, because come on, it's supposed to be native code. It has to be hopefully faster, but definitely not slower. And it has to be tested, because that's what you do. And currently, the media library code on most mobile ports is tested by a developer once every month, like manually tested. So this project was started with unit testing and functional testing in mind. So we have, like, I guess, 160 unit tests so far, and I guess a dozen of functional tests, which are run on each commit. And so we know if we break something. So now a bit about the difficulties of doing that. So as I mentioned, you have like some quite crazy cases with artists which have the same name, or albums which share the same name, of like, I don't know, three albums with the same name in the same year. And it happens. But also, when?
Did you send questions to the artist?
But so it has to run on multiple platforms, and multiple platforms means depending on which broken APIs or broken OSs in general, broken STL, for instance, doing C++11 on Android, if you don't use C-Lang, is just like, well, just shoot yourself and get some time. On Windows RT, for instance, you're not exactly allowed to browse through a directory because it's unsafe. And you have to use some async APIs, which are not exactly available to you in C++. And you, well, that's still being solved. But if you're running your code on multiple platforms, as you probably quite a few of you know, it's, well, kind of a pain in the lower back. And also, well, you just have like the meta information for your media, meaning if the media is not properly filled, you still gotta do, well, you still have to do it without knowing much more. So if you don't have an artist, well, that's easy. It's unknown artist, and that's it. But if you have featurings, it you have to do with what you provided. So the current status of the media library. So we are roughly at like 15,000 lines of code. It's integrated in the Tizen port because, well, that allows us to have like a live example, a live test. But if I ask you how many here are using a Tizen phone, except the one who pretends he does. So you get the idea why we started with that port. Now we currently integrated it we're integrating it on the Android port, as Geoffrey mentioned. So hopefully it will be ready soon-ish. We also are integrating it in VLMC, and I'll talk more about that probably in the VLMC talk in a few hours. WinRT will come next as soon as we know how to browse a directory. Not a joke. Oh, I mean, yeah, sure, you could use OpenDR, but no. No, it's not available. Yeah, my state of life. And that's it for the media library. Now I'll let Felix take over.
Hi, I'm Felix, and I'm going to conclude with what we did on the Apple platforms for the last year, basically. So for iOS, we started in 2013 by rewriting more or less everything which could not be relicensed from a certain company based in Paris. And so that was the very first prototype we demoed internally back then. And since then, it's being distributed under MPLv2 with certain playback components from mainline VLC. We currently have like 12 million users on iPad, iPhone, and iPod Touch, and we see like 15,000 downloads every day. So what we did since last year is what we call desktop quality subtitle rendering. So long story short, subtitles are looking like they're supposed to look like, and we can finally use the fonts provided by the operating system, and we no longer need to bundle fonts with the app itself. Last year, Tobias ported VLC to watchOS 2. As you probably don't know because you don't care about Apple Watch, on watchOS 1, the Apple Watch application was running on the phone and the watch was only used as an external display. And in watchOS 2, we moved to like a native application running natively on the watch, which is a lot faster and which got an independent media database. So as soon as we are moving to media library written by Google, we will also need to move that media library to watchOS, which will be an interesting experience. And so since last year, we added support for iOS 9. iOS 9 was introduced with the iPhone 6S, which finally got that force touch display. So if you're pushing harder, other things are happening than compared when you're not pushing as hard. So we added those right-click menus. We added support for system-wide search, which is, I'm not sure that's even available on Android. So when you're searching for content on your phone, it's going to browse the internet, it's going to browse your contacts, and it's also going to browse the media stored inside VLC, so you can find your movies without going inside the app. And we added support for right-to-left languages, like we did on Android as well. So the UI flips if you're switching to Hebrew or to Arabic UIs. Continuing on iOS 9 support, we added split-screen support on iPad, which requires more or less the latest iPad, so you can run two applications at the same time. We don't have access to the multi-window UI you have on iOS, so you don't have the pop-over style like you have on Android, but at least you can run a web browser and VLC side-by-side. And we added what we call shared login credentials. So if you're using the same Apple account on multiple iOS devices, you can share your login credentials between VLC. So when you're logging into a web server once, you will have the same credentials available on the other. And we added support for Touch ID, which is the fingerprinting sensor available on a couple of phones to lock VLC. And of course, if you enable that locking mechanism, your content won't be available in the system-wide search anymore, because otherwise it would be kind of useless to lock your app instance. The big thing we did this January was releasing VLC for Apple TV, for which we did a completely custom UI, which is fully different from what we do on iOS, providing more or less the same feature set. So you can browse the servers the way Thomas explained how we implemented server browsing in the VLC 3. And we added a web interface which allows you to control playback on Apple TV using a web browser running on another computer. All those Apple TV and iOS ports are powered by something we call VLC Kit. For those who are unfamiliar with that, that's an Objective-C framework written around libvlc and wrapping a lot of custom code you need on any Apple platform to make VLC run. We finally added support for multi-threaded OpenGL. So what you can see in the screenshot here is that you have that monster on top, which is an OpenGL rendering and spinning around itself. And you have that beaver down there running at the same time in the same application. So you can mix as many OpenGL constructs in the same output window. We added support for something called bitcode, which is an intermediate compilation step, which is not really linked and not really optimized, but some intermediate compilation step in between. So you don't upload an executable binary to Apple servers, but Apple servers are constantly recompiling your app for delivery to update the C-Link version available on Apple servers. Supposedly that's some sort of speed improvement. And of course, we had to find a solution how to embed the assembly code from FFmpeg to make it work. We finally made VLC Kit thread safe, so you can start playback commands from whatever thread you are on, and you don't need to go back to the main thread to do so. We dropped support for 32-bit on Macs because, I mean, even Microsoft Office is supporting 64-bit on Mac now, so it was about time to do so. And we added predefined dialogues for the dialog API Toma added, so you don't have to re-implement your dialogues, but you still can. Finally, on the Mac, we added the same hardware-accelerated video decoding we did for iOS. So we did our own video toolbox decoder, which can be used instead of the video tuber's decoder in FFmpeg, which allows us to do zero copy rendering, so be a lot faster than what FFmpeg is doing. We added keyboard dimming, so when you're playing stuff, your keyboard will not glow anymore, but it will be less visible, so it's nicer in that way. We improved AppleScript support because apparently people are still asking for it. And we also added right-to-left support, so we switched the entire UI finally to something we call auto-layouts, so the button sizes are adapting to the label size you're printing on that, so you have a bigger button for German text and a smaller button for English text. And when you're in a right-to-left environment, the buttons will also flip in the UI. We wrote the memory management completely on the Mac UI to have something called automated reference counting. So this is a compiler technique which allows you to not care about memory management at all, but have the compiler do it for you. So it's no longer like in C where you have to actually free your objects, but the compiler is doing that for you. And finally, we added that small menu up there, which is probably familiar to any Windows user, but is very uncommon on the Mac, so you finally have a way to control VLC without switching to VLC. So we are done with our presentation, and we are happy to answer questions for all of us.
Any non-trolling question? Yes, Ronald. That's a bit complex to answer right now, but we can discuss that tomorrow at the end conference. Yes?
Last year, I know there have been some concerns expressed about GT4 versus GT5.
Is that still on the roadmap? Yes, this is getting solved, mostly because if you want to have high DPI actually working, you need Qt 5. The problem is basically you need Qt 5.6 to get it correct on Windows, but there are regressions on Windows. I think two of them are fixed. There is one missing. The problem is that they starting from 5.7, they will not support XP or Vista, so that's a bit too early for us. But fortunately, 5.6 is a long-time support. So everything should be fixed by the 3.0 times. Yes?
On the TVOS port, are you doing hardware accelerated
No, because for hardware accelerated support, you would need to have something called Video Toolbox, which we are using on iOS and on the Mac. And Video Toolbox is no longer being distributed on TVS because, it's soft deprecated. And there's a new framework called Video Processing, which is a private API and may not be accessed on TVS.
Yes, Ben?
Okay. Are you working on Microsoft Car Player?
I think no one wants to touch that with a 10-foot pool, so we are not.
Or Tesla?
Nope. But if you have a Tesla sample to offer, I would. Okay. Other question, and there was someone else. Yes, Guillaume. The problem we have is that basically we kind of did a mistake, and not really a mistake, but we spoke about Chromecast, and then people were in berserk because they want Chromecast, and we have a few stuff to iron out, and we can't do a major release without Chromecast, else people are going to actually go down my place and kill me physically. Yes. Especially since the Videoland nonprofit address is my parents' place, and as some of you know, I've already received some not nice letters there. So jokes, half joking aside, we need to get that finished for 3.0. I hope that we are going to iron the few big issues for core next week, and we can freeze. The nightly builds, weirdly, are not in that bad state, which is unexpected at this time, to be honest. Last question. Yes, Steve? Why do you have questions? No, you're not allowed to ask questions. I think it's already enabled.
Yeah, I mean, there was an Ars Technica talk about that, no?
Yes. Okay. Okay, I think we have a 12 minutes and 32 seconds break before the next presentation. Be there in 12 minutes and now 25 seconds.